And her clothes smelled like marijuanas. And I remember Raheem, he didn't come to school with the same dirty school uniform on. I don't want to get Shaquita in trouble, but I'm a teacher, which means I'm obligated to tell you if I think a child is being neglected. And because you told that white woman that you're a single mom, three kids, living in your mama's basement, the principal is going to use that. They call Child Protective Services, and they're going to come out to your house, and the next thing you know, they're telling you, if you don't get them put on no medicine, we're going to take your children. Oh, yes. Talking too much destroys black families. Talking too much destroys black families. Black mother, the worst thing you can do is go to school looking for sympathy, because you're not going to get it, but you will be set up to lose your kids. And then some of you say, what do they want our kids for? Well, number one, America has the fastest growing LGBT population in the world. And they cannot produce biological children of their own. So guess where they're going to get them from? Your house! Black kids are disproportionately given to LGBT foster parents. If you don't believe me, do the research. Black kids without a home are damn near guaranteed to end up with same-sex mother and father. And because black people don't like to adopt our own kids because we're selfish as hell, they're almost guaranteed to end up with white folks. And they don't even like it, but they'd rather have a home than no home at all. Not to mention that the Child Protective Services industry is in bed with the undercover Hollywood and New York City music industry pedophile rings. That you got judges and politicians and mayors right here in New York who are part of an international pedophile ring. And guess where they get most of their child victims from? From Child Protective Services. So going to your child's school and telling all your business is the quickest way to get them inducted in the world of child sex exploitation. Keep your mouth shut. Rule number five, this is for black mothers in particular. Rule number five, black mother, do me a damn favor. When you drop your kids off in the morning for school, would you please stop wearing your pajamas into the damn school building? You damn ghetto rats. You don't wear pajamas to the damn school. The hell wrong with y'all? And you got a girl to think you cute with your big old bunny socks on? Old nasty weave all lopsided? Sleep in your eye? I saw a mother coming in with a damn Gucci pajama set on, but I'm broke ass. Embarrassing the hell out of me. You don't go to the school with no damn pajamas on. Do you know what you're telling white folks when you do that? You're saying to them, I have no life. I have nothing to do. No priorities. And as soon as I drop them off, I'm going to go back in bed and keep on rerunning the Cardi B twerk video. And guess what? They're going to call you even more now. Never let the school know you're not employed. Did you hear me, mothers? Don't you ever go to that school and say, I'm out of work now. That's the worst thing you can tell them. Parents who don't work are more likely to see their kids suspended, especially if they're black. And I'm gonna tell you something else. Black mother, stop letting them white folks know that you're single without a man at home. Stop letting them white folks know that you're single. Y'all love to brag about how single you are. I'm a single mom. I'm a mommy and a daddy. You can't never be no daddy. There ain't no woman in here no father. You can't be that. That's not your energy. I don't care how many chemicals and hormones you done took. I don't care how many surgeries you done had. I don't care how hard your walk is. I was walking up the street earlier with two lesbian sisters so bad. She said, it's not you. She said, I'm straight. They got real hard on you. Yeah. and femininity. For light you have dark, for sun you have moon, for water you have land, for the man you got the woman, for the yin you got yang. Perfect balance. Whenever you upset the balance, you upset the natural, healthy psychology of the child. Of the child. Okay? Our sons need a mother and they need a father. And our daughters need a mother and father. They are equally important. Equally important. Now, my mothers, I know you love your sons, and I want you to. But don't love them so much that you forget to raise them. Too many black mothers are loving their sons and not raising their sons. You're turning him into the same type of man you would never want to marry yourself. Stop saying we ain't got no good black men. The reason we ain't got no good black men is y'all ruining the boys, some of you. Your daughter, she responsible. Your daughter, she's hardworking. Your daughter, she got a job, she got a scholarship, she's on the Champion Club, and then look at his ass. Raheem is only 12 with 15 tattoos already. He talks to his mother like she's dirty, and you let him do it. You know why? Because when a woman don't have a man in her life, she only upgrades her oldest son as her mate. For many single mothers, their oldest son is their husband. And we all, not sex, psychology. And when your oldest son becomes your husband, he becomes your source of support. And just like you can punish him, he can punish you. No more pajamas at school. Rule number six. Whenever your child gets psychologically evaluated and you don't agree with the report, get it back. I want everybody here to hear me. You have a federal right. Whenever you disagree with the school's evaluation, you have a federal right to an independent educational evaluation. Everybody say this right after me. IEE.
IEE.
Say IEE.
IEE.
IEE means independent educational evaluation. This is a United States special ed law. I don't care if you live in New York or North Dakota. Whenever you get a report saying your son or daughter is autistic or reading disabled or retarded or ADHD or emotionally disturbed, you have a right to say, I don't agree with it. You then have a right to go find your own psychologist. You have a right to have them test the child and the school district pays for it. I know because I do it in Pennsylvania all the time. So don't ever tell me, my son is in special ed and ain't nothing I can do. Yes, it is. You could have rejected the request to place him. And I'm going to tell you something else. Rule number six. I need y'all to learn how to just say no. When they come to you and say, we think you got a reading disability, can we test them? No! Yell at their ass. No! You can't be nice. See, y'all want to be nice. Well, I'm not sure if he really has a reading problem. I don't really know about it. See, that's weak. Because see, that tells them they can convince you. Y'all too, well, can I think about it? Ain't nothing to think about. No! Yell at it. No! Crack it over! And then some of you say, well, Dr. Umar, if I tell them no, they just want to keep being persistent. Then you got to put it in a letter. Dr. Silverberger. Mrs. Betty, school Nalini, keeps bugging me about getting my son tested. I done told her two times, I don't want no evaluation. So I'm writing you as the principal of the school, and I'm asking you to please stop your teacher from harassing me. My son is not being tested for special ed. The only people who need special ed in this school are your teachers. Are y'all following me? In fact, 90% of all the children I've evaluated in my life never had a learning disability at all. They had another disability that I call ABT. Everybody say ABT.
ABT.
ABT. And guess what that stands for? That's Dr. Umar's diagnosis. And it stands for, he's not reading disabled. He just ain't never been taught. You ever heard of that? Third grade, reading disability. Let me see who the teacher was in second grade.
That's right.
Second grade, math disability. Let me see what school he was at for kindergarten. Because kindergarten has become daycare. I don't know if y'all know that. They're not even teaching kids how to write their name and colors and letters and numbers and size. They don't teach them nothing. They sit there and they watch SpongeBob and fill out photocopies all day. Listen, if your child is in third grade and they're struggling, get them a tutor. You don't give him an IEP, because once you put your child in special ed, the longer they stay in special ed, the more they look like they need it. The longer they stay in special ed, the more they look like they need it. What do you mean, Dr. Umar? I'll give you an example. Your daughter is in the sixth grade. She's reading on the fourth grade level. First of all, if she was my daughter, she wouldn't even be getting tested. Why not? She's 2 grade levels behind. Really? How about most of the kids in her box who are 2 grade levels behind? Who the hell chose my baby to go to special ed? Are y'all following me? Listen, I'm not saying being 2 grades behind is acceptable. It's not. We believe in black excellence. We believe in black excellence. We believe in black excellence. But what I'm saying is, if most kids in black school districts are 2 grades but beneath level, shouldn't we be coming up with an intervention for the whole school?
That's
right. Why are we coming up with an intervention for one kid?
Yeah.
And by the way, my Bronx parents, if I'm the first to tell you, special education is not a program. Special education is a business. And special education is a business of making money off of lazy black kids who we never taught in the first place. Oh yes, whenever Dr. Umar does an evaluation, guess what I gotta do after I do the evaluation? If I qualify that child for special ed, which means as a certified school psychologist, I have determined based on the evidence, because I can't prove, I have determined based on evidence that this child is deaf, blind, speech and language impaired, traumatic brain injury, orthopedic impairment, learning disability, autism, emotional disturbance, other health impairment, developmental delay. If I give any one of those 13 labels, their name goes into a computer in New York City public schools, send their name to the state, and by the end of the month, the school gets a welfare check for your child. Special education ain't nothing but money. Special ed ain't nothing but a hustle. Special ed ain't nothing but a racket. You want to know how the black kids never get out? Because it's too much money to be made keeping them in. Oh, these are the facts.
Yes.
These are the absolute facts. That's why when we open up the Frederick Douglass Marcus Garvey Academy. Yeah. All you niggas is taking the homie. These niggas is doing what I got your ass. I got two schools. You damn dusty, you two broke ass, ain't got nothing for nobody else. Well, let me ask you a question. Who in here stood strong with me through the hate? Who stood strong with me through the hate? One love. Oh, yes. You got us the school, brothers and sisters. And the haters ain't stopped there. Yeah, they said, I made it up. They said, I broke into a building, hired a film crew, put on the stove. And did a 25-minute video before the owner got back. Now they looking for the deed. They said, I paid $10. For 4 buildings on a campus that cost $13 million when they built it. So if you keep me in school for $2.50, I think we would have owned it already. But we not worried about that. We got the nation built.
Yeah.
And at that Frederick Douglass Law and Army Academy, I'm going to teach your son 6 sciences. I'm going to teach them political and military science. They got to understand white supremacy upside down and backwards and forwards. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. And if you don't want me to teach them the truth, don't send them to my school. Because we're private. We're not government funded. So if you come in and act like a coon, I'm going to kick your ass. White supremacy, because y'all need to learn this too.
Yeah.
See, you didn't graduate from the Frederick Douglass Law Academy. You graduated with We Hate Black Kids, New York City Public. What's the first rule of racism? First rule of racism. First rule of racism. First rule of racism.
Control.
Is all white people are racist.
That's right.
Look how quiet it is and then you pick up this control. Everyone.
That's
they
right.
Calls, they birds, they cats, they snakes, all of that. And here's why you have a conflict with that statement. You have a conflict with that statement because you believe racism equals racial hatred. When I say all white people are racist, I didn't say all white people hate black people. In fact, the best racists love you. They speak with your women. They speak with your men. They play hip hop. They know how to twerk. They got businesses in your neighborhood. They dress like you. They talk like you. The best. The best racists know how to imitate black folks.
That's right.
Here's what I need y'all to understand when I say all white people are racist. Racism is not about hating black people. Racism is not about wanting to exterminate black people. You got white people who hate blacks. You got white people who want to exterminate blacks. Not every white person wants to exterminate you. Not every white person wants to hate you. So why do you say they're all racist? They're not who you are. Because racism is not about hate. Racism is about control. Every white person in New York loves the white privilege that they live on.
Yes.
And they have no problem with you suffering in order for them to enjoy it.
Yes.
Racism ain't got nothing to do with hating. It's all about power and control. Those white women who got Bill Cosby locked up, they sexed him up, took pills with him, got drunk. But at the end of the day, when they own white men called them up and said, would you do us a favor?
That's right. That's right.
They did.
No, that's right.
You saw with Ezekiel Elliott, the running back for the Cowboys.
Yes.
When he got in trouble last season, he heard his white girl told him what each other. She said, you're black. They're not going to believe you even if you make $1 million. Oh, yes. Racism ain't about no damn money. I heard a Negro say, the only color matter is green. But who makes the money green, you coon?
Teeth.
Racism is about power and privilege. Even when a black man got a white woman, this is why it's so dangerous to date white girls, because all she got to do is say you did something. You know how many black athletes I know who lost their full scholarships in college because the white girl got mad and accused them of rape? White girls know they got the upper hand even when you on top of them. Yes, Negroes. But you got black men talking about I don't date black women because they take too much money. Look what the white women are doing in the divorce court. Did y'all see RG3?
Yeah.
This Negro broke and his white wife said she needs $16,000 a week to live. I hope she had a butt implant or something. Brothers and sisters, if we want to save the black family, we got to save it ourselves. And black men and black women, we got to stop all this hating I'm seeing on YouTube. The black woman is laughing at the black black man knocking at the black woman. We supposed to be fighting together. Mm-hmm. And if you think the black man is who he is because he's lazy, you need to do your history. Two-parent black families were the norm in this country from the day we got here. Even in slavery, when it was illegal to get married, we still married. When do you see the rise of the single black female-headed household? 1970, not 1865. We was married through slavery. We was married through Jim Crow. We was married through civil rights. So how did we get here, Dr. Lamar? Let me explain it. 1968, they killed Dr. King. Why did the FBI kill Dr. King and how did the Taliban lobby to do it? They killed Dr. King because Dr. King was about to get involved in economic empowerment. Right?
Yes.
They said integrated lunch counters is fine, but this nigga was talking about the only thing that can ever save black folks from government intervention, and that's redistribution of America's wealth. Don't talk to me about being an American citizen. Don't talk to me about being equal. Don't talk to me about being free until you redistribute the wealth. Dr. King was going to lead a breadbasket march. He was going to bring poor black, poor white, poor Mexican, poor everybody. And they was going to go to Washington, D.C. in the fall of 68. And they was going to build a tent city. And no one under Dr. King's leadership was going to leave Washington, D.C. until everybody left with a job and a decent place to live. That would have embarrassed the United States government. They couldn't allow it. So King was murdered on the orders of J. Edgar Hoover with the assistance of the Ku Klux Klan, the Memphis Police Department, the Memphis Fire Department, and the Italian Mafia. The same Italian Mafia that used to flood your community with dope in the 60s. And after they killed Dr. King, they said, we will never let the black power revolution happen. Ever again. I don't think y'all understand, but the 1960s almost broke the back of the United States government. They had to deal with the Nation of Islam, the Garvey Movement, 8-Track Ram, Stokely Carmichael, SNCC, CORE, the Freedom Riders, the Citizens, the Black Panther Party. They had all these different groups who honestly believed that black people had a right to be equal. So after they killed King, they said, we got to change this. Because we can never let this happen. We trying to fight a war in Vietnam so we can get a damn oil pipeline driven, and we got radical liberals burning cities down. How can we stop it? Somebody said, who's financing these black organizations? Because we're not. The government ain't financing the Nation of Islam. The government ain't financing the Black Panther Party. The government ain't financing SNCC and CORE.
Right.
They said they own people giving them money. And the government said, how are they own people financing King and Malcolm? And they said, because most people in the black community are self-employed skills men and skills women. They know how to work with their hands. They're bakers and barbers and electricians and plumbers and carpenters and metal workers and welders and all of the kids. They own their own businesses. So white men said, we got to kill that. And in 1970, it came into Harlem. It came into the Bronx. It came into Brooklyn, came into Queens, came into Staten Island, came into Newark, New Jersey, came into Patterson, Camden, and it went into the high schools and took out all the industrial building training programs. Up until 1970, you didn't need a college degree to live a decent life. You graduated with a cosmetology license, you graduated with a plumber's license, you graduated with an electrician's license, you graduated with a welding license. But after 1970, it would never be the same again. After 1970, they would tell every last one of you to send your kids to college. And as a result of that, everybody in this room, me included, been going to college. Because somebody told you, if you want to be successful, go to college. So if you go to college and you get your associate's degree, I got my associate's. Go get your weed going, cap again. Then you go looking for a job. You don't have enough credits under your belt. Damn, let me go get a bachelor's. You go get your bachelor's, I know I can get a job now. You know, you don't have enough liberal arts, and we don't see enough math courses. I'm sorry, you're about 3 credits short. Get a master's. You go get your master's, go back. I'm sorry, we changed the requirements for the job. You know what I'm gonna do? I'm just gonna get my doctorate. I'm tired of this race. You got your PhD. You know you're good now. Magna cum laude, PhD in grasshopper reproduction on the moon. I know I'm gonna get the job. Sorry. You still don't qualify. This is what they do with black people. They waste 30 years in your life sending you in educational service for a job they never want to hire you for anyway. And as a result of that, you got 2 million black people in America with master's and doctorate degrees unemployed right now. Raise your hand if you owe student loans. Look around this room. Look at this. This is a damn crisis. You put your hands down. I got 6 degrees. You can imagine. Brothers and sisters, they have sold us a scam. We will be paying them loans back the rest of our lives. So Dr. Umar, are you saying I shouldn't send my daughter to college? No, I'm not. But I am saying you better answer 3 questions to me. Question number 1. Did you raise your daughter or son with enough self-discipline to finish school without them living with you? Because most of you have raised shameless, lazy children who don't do nothing unless they feel like it. And that is a problem because we all know that you have to learn how to do what you don't like to do to be in a place to do what you want to do. And most of us have children who cannot do that. What is the number one job of a black parent? The number one job of a black parent in the Bronx is to teach your child discipline. And what is Dr. Umar Johnson's definition of discipline? It's the ability to do what you don't want to do when it has to be done, whether you like it or not. Does your son have that? Does your daughter have that? Because if they don't, I want to know why you're spending $30,000 a year for Spelman and Howard and Clark and the University of Pennsylvania, and some of you may grow since your child a collar or more. That day we're smoking blunts all day. So question number 1, do they have the discipline to finish? Because I'm seeing too many black kids flunk out after 2 years, come home, no degree, $50,000 in debt. Question number 2, are they majoring in something economically relevant that will allow them to pay back those student loans after they're done? No. Your son got a PhD in alien transformation. Who the hell looking for a damn alien worker? I'm at a big row. He had a master's degree in liberal arts. I said, which one? He said, it ain't one, it's just liberal. I said, you're going to be so liberated, you won't even have to get a job. Make sure what they major in is relevant, because these colleges in New York City are very, very manipulative. Yes. Only 20 programs matter. The other 30 are only used to pay bills. You ever be looking at the back of the public transportation bus and they say, we have a new master's degree in community organizing? Excuse me. Where black people get over there? And then you look at the professor. Who's the professor?
White person.
Dr. Chinyang Wok. And speaking of him, that better stop eating from these Chinese schools. Trump administration is in bed with the Chinese stopping those. And that they put poison in the food they eat black folks. And the reason I believe this is because you have never seen license and inspection at a Chinese restaurant. They cook it with the same grease they made chicken wings for your grandmother with. And they haven't been put out of business yet. But let you open up a black restaurant. That's an out here every day. Your stall too small. You need another door. The bathroom seat ain't the right color. Chinese folks can do whatever they want. And you Negroes love those wings so much. You know they got wings, but you're the big ones. That ain't no damn wing. Who you ever seen chicken gizzards in the market? And you know what's sad? I was in China, and they are racist as hell. Listen, in China they don't have no civil rights there. So guess what? This place is in China, black people can't. Guess what? This store is in China, black people can't go. Guess what? This nightclub, we outside, and I don't party because I ain't got no rhythm, my white ancestor cursed me. But we was about to go to the club. And the brother said, Doc, you can't go over there. I said, what? He said, black people can't go in there. I said, what? He said, that club don't allow black people. The Chinese are racist. And guess what they do? Because they're not used to seeing black people in real life. If you ever go to China, I'm telling you that, you're going to be smacking a lot of Chinese people. Because they will pull out their phone, don't ask your permission, and take your damn picture. I want them to understand interest in banking, picking stocks. Every child will have a bank account. Every child will have a penny stock account. Every child will have a business plan, not ninth grade or fifth.
That's right. Yes,
yes, yes. Because I see the tide of us being wage slaves. Yes. And along with political science, we got to teach black children about the black bourgeoisie of New York City. See, remember now, first rule of racism is all white people racist. Second rule of racism is white people don't share power with black folks. Did y'all hear me? White people don't share power with black people. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. 10 years ago in Harlem, they said, we're going to build a Harlem for everyone.
You should see it today.
Now live in Harlem today. White folks don't live with black folks, they move you out.
Yes.
Because white people don't share power with black folks. If you don't believe me, name me a business that white folks have ever owned equally with black folks. They don't.
Wow.
They don't.
That's true.
Russell Simmons used to own that jam. Not no more.
Right.
Famous Amos Cookies, he used to have the cookies. Not no more. White folks, you hear Negroes say I'm going into business with a white man, you know he just better cool.
Right.
What's the third rule of racism? The ends justify the means.
Woo.
We will poison your water. We will give your women dirty birth control pills that we know lead to all sorts of fibroid tumors. We will pump AIDS and Ebola out West Nile. We will give your sons this measles, mumps, and rebellious shot that we know causes autism.
Talk about it.
White folks will do anything to get rid of you because what's the reason of racism in the first place? White genetic survival.
That's right.
They have to control you to make sure they can survive. Because one black man in a nation of white women can turn the color of the people tan in 50 years, brown in 75, and all black in 100. See, black men always ask me, Dr. Umar, why do they hate us so much? Brother, you don't understand why? You ain't got to have no money, no job. You can be homeless, two strikes. But guess what? You got a white man, Chinese man, Arab, East Indian, and an African. They can have all the money, all the businesses, but guess what you got that none of them got? Genetic superiority.
That's right. Yes, yes, sir.
You make a baby with a Chinese
black
woman, it's a black. You make a baby with the East Indian woman, it's black. You make a baby with the Anglo-Saxon woman, it's black. The black man is the only man on the planet who has 100% genetic superiority. This is why when you walk into a room full of white girls and there's some white guys in there, they get a little insecure. Especially if you swag delicious. White men start shaking because white women have a natural attraction to the black man's melanin.
Yes, they
do. It's natural. On a subconscious level, they know that melanin equals longevity for their species. So without even thinking about it, they want to reproduce with the black man to stay around. They don't know what drives them to the tall, dark, and handsome. They just know that they're driven to it. So y'all think the white man is afraid and intimidated because of the black man's size? No, not every black man is blessed. Black women know. Some of y'all had Chinese wings. It's not the size, it's the strength of the DNA. Same thing with a black woman. Any man put a seed in a black woman as African. No matter where you go in the world, you make yourself. You're the only people in the world who can do that. That's why they hate you, and they want to get rid of every last one of you to ensure that they survive. I know you don't want to hear me say this, but the African is the only human being who is 100% human.
Yes, we are.
All of the other group, the ice cracker, the sand cracker, and the mountain cracker. They all had traces of Neanderthal DNA. All of them. They are cousins. All three of them. That's why the Arab is classified as white on the United States Census.
Yep.
They are family. We are family.
Yes.
All my Neanderthal cousins and me. We ain't got no friends, nobody like us.
Nobody.
We are God's chosen people.
Yes.
Y'all got it screwed up. Y'all, is it the Hebrews? Is it the Muslims? Is it the... No, it's the Africans!
Yes.
We're the chosen people. We're the first and only complete man. Somebody said, why did God put us down here to suffer like this, Dr. Umar? I said, why do you blame God for your suffering? Because what was happening? That ain't God. You did that. The Right Honorable Marcus Messiah Garvey, who gave us the largest black organization in modern history, said if black people would really get to know themselves, we could create a new reality in 24 hours.
Yes.
I mean, listen, last year, you spent $2 billion on Air Jordans, $4 billion on liquor and alcohol. Black woman, $16 billion on weeds and perms.
Not me.
And I'm not knocking no black woman in here with a weed and a perm, sister. And let me tell you why I'm not knocking you at all. First of all, I love you whether you earned or not. But the reason I'm not going to knock you is because I know most black women with processed hair were encouraged to look like that by processed black male Negroes. The black woman knows that the black man wants her to look like a Neanderthal, so she tries to recreate the Neanderthal complex. If black men valued black women as natural, they would be natural in 24 hours, every last one. But because we want a black woman's body but a white woman's complexion.
That's ridiculous.
They process themselves. So black men, I want you to do me a favor. This is Black History Month. This is our 400 years in America, 1619, 2019, for those whose ancestors came on ships. And mine did. I know some of y'all did. I met a Native American down the street. Looked like an African to me, but he said it was me. He must have had a blunt. I said, it's amazing you Negroes are so Native, because if you go to check out with the five major Native American tribes, every last one of them, because you know they got these reserves for casinos on them. Did you know that every last one of them wrote into their charters that no African American can claim any type of right to the wealth of their reserve? They wrote your ass out. You running around, silly ass. I met a Negro, said his name was Chief Tomahawk.
Thank you, good brother.
He had on some Gucci, a Louis bag, and some skinny jeans. I said, your ass, your name is Chief Tomahawk.
Thank you, good brother.
Brothers and sisters, I'm not voting for no more black folks unless they can answer three questions for me. If I lived in the Bronx, I wouldn't cast another ballot unless the candidate can answer three questions for me. I don't care if you live in Philadelphia, Florida, New Jersey, Harlem, or Queens. Three questions. Question number one, are you a Democrat or Republican? Because if you're not an independent candidate, I don't vote for you. Because if you're not an independent candidate, you're not an independent thinker. Oh, yes. You want to know why the black politicians in New York City don't do nothing for you? Not all, you got a few exceptions, peace, but most of them are sellouts. You want to know why? Because they all belong to the Democratic Party. They have to do whatever the Democratic bosses tell them to do. Because they have to be part of the team, the white racist team. And the Democratic Party don't care about black people in the Bronx. So if you vote for black Democrats, they don't care about you either.
That's right.
I only vote for independent black candidates. I only vote for independent black candidates. You want to know why they don't do nothing for you? Because they get their money from the Democratic Party. Every black politician in America, Cory Booker and Kamala Harris included, are financed by white people. How can you carry out a black agenda and you finance by white people? And Republicans ain't no bad. I don't get down with either one of them. We need independent. And once we open up to Frederick Douglass Marcus Garvey, I'm going to try to influence every last one of you to give up your party affiliations and join the independent black political, not party. We don't need a party. We need a union. So guess what? Somebody want to be mayor of New York? You going to come and meet with the black political union, because we got some questions. And we're going to listen to the Republicans and the Democrats and the Green Party and the Libertarians and the Independents. And then we're going to get in a room like this by ourselves, fight it out, debate it out, argue it out, discuss it out, and decide who we going back. And then we're going to go to that person. We're going to say, guess what? You're going to be mayor next week. And they're going to say, how do you know? And you're going to say, because you're getting every black vote in the Bronx. But let's explain something to you. We got some brothers who don't mind whipping some ass. So once you get elected, if you even think you're going to renege on these brothers, your ass will wake up in a bed full of chicken wings from the Chinese restaurant. So you better do what the hell you told us to do. In the next election, we will vote your ass right back out. See, the reason black people are taken for granted, because you're the only constituency in America who doesn't vote as a team. Irish vote as a team. European Jews vote as a team. Mexicans vote as a team. Arabs vote as a team. And black people vote as individuals. And as long as you vote as individuals, you will be ignored, rejected, and laughed at. You know what you are politically? A cheap prostitute. You don't even have to pay. They come and get your vote every 4 years, send you away, and then 4 years later, they go find some Negro to scare you enough. Notice how black people are motivated to vote through fear. Everybody else is motivated to vote through gains. Jews don't vote because they're scared. Jews vote because somebody told them they're going to promise them something. Arabs vote because somebody said they're going to promise them something. Homosexuals vote because somebody said they're going to promise them something. Black people vote because some Negro paid by the Democrats made them so scared that if you don't vote for Hillary, you won't get nothing. And then you said, but Trump, Hillary ain't gonna give me nothing. Trump ain't giving me. I know, but at least it's the lesser of the two evils. What the hell is the lesser of a two evils? They can't get no worse than Barack Obama. Don't get quiet now. Don't get quiet now. You Negroes love Obama. I keep asking my Obama maniacs one question. I ain't got to answer yet. One question. Can you name one thing? One thing Barack Obama did exclusively for blacks? I can name three things he did for homosexuals. I can name two things he did for white women. I can name three things he did for illegal immigrants. I can't name one thing he did for blacks. Because you Negroes are cheap. You had this thing where if he looks like me, he's automatically for me. Wrong. Cory Booker ain't got no black agenda. Kamala Harris is married to a damn Neanderthal. You know she ain't got no black agenda. They gonna be Barack Obama 2.0 on your ass. And the black feminists think you're gonna win something if Kamala, oh, you have a woman now. That woman is gonna destroy the black family so much you won't even have a man to date no matter what he is when she gets finished. She can't stand black males.